2008 was in the middle of what we in the United States call the Great Recession, and you in Europe call the global financial crisis. And during that time, a big old factory called the Janesville Assembly Plant, that was the oldest operating General Motors assembly plant in the whole company, closed down in Janesville, Wisconsin, which is a small city in southern Wisconsin. This was an auto plant that had been started just after World War I and began making Chevrolets on Valentine's Day of 1923. So for generations of people in this small city, this plant had the best working class jobs you could imagine. They were well paid, they had good benefits, and suddenly all those jobs were gone. Well, I was looking for a place to write about because I really was, I can only say, obsessed with finding a way to tell the story of what it really meant for a perfectly ordinary community and the people who live there to have a lot of good work go away. And as you say, this happened in many places, both in the United States and in Europe. But I was looking for a place that had never before been part of what we call the Rust Belt, which is part of the Midwest that has had a long history of industrial trouble. I wanted a place where economic trouble was brand new. And Janesville was that kind of a place. Its economy had been very healthy for decades, and suddenly about 9,000 jobs went away in 2008 and 2009. Janesville also had a very interesting political history. It was a place that had a very strong union, part of the United Auto Workers. People tended to vote Democratic, but it had both a very conservative new governor and a conservative congressman named Paul Ryan, who people might know now because he went on to become the House Speaker. He wasn't that powerful at the time, but when I was choosing a place, I thought it might be interesting to have this juxtaposition between a union town and the conservatism of the political leaders from there. Well, that was the central question that I went there to try to explore. You know, there had been a lot of writing done about jobs that left, and I wanted to know what happens next. Or as I came to think about it, what choices do people make when there were no good choices left? So I focused on a few families that made different kinds of choices about what to do. In one case, one of the families that I wrote close up about had been a strong union family for several generations. And after thinking about it, the guy who had been an auto worker in that family trained to go into management, to do human resources work. That was a pretty hard values adjustment for him, but he thought it was the best thing he could think of to do that would take advantage of the skills he had developed as a union leader. In another family, the man who had worked at General Motors, a guy in his late 30s at the time who had a wife and three daughters, he eventually took a job with a General Motors plant hundreds of miles away in Indiana. And he still, to this day, leaves home on early Monday morning, drives about 5 hours to this plant in Indiana, several states away, works there all week, and comes home late on Friday nights. And that's how he decided to help his family get their way back up into the middle class. The third family I write about decided not to have anybody leave town, and they're really the family that falls the farthest out of the middle class. The husband in that family has bounced in and out of a whole series of just bad paid jobs. And this family had teenage girls when I first met them, and they were great kids. They were very good students. Their teachers loved them. They were popular. And they were, when I met them as high school seniors, working 5 part-time jobs between them to help the family pay the bills. Well, the whole question of who can help a community recover economically was something I was keenly interested in. So I looked at what the federal government was doing, what the state of Wisconsin was doing, and also what the people of Janesville and small grassroots nonprofits in town were doing for themselves to try to help people. So the state tried at first very hard to persuade General Motors not to close this plant. The state combined with the city of Janesville and the union and a couple of nearby communities from which people commuted to Janesville to work put up a lot of money as an economic incentive to try to persuade General Motors to give the Janesville Assembly Plant a new small car to manufacture. And even though it was a record offer that the state of Wisconsin made, they lost out to Michigan, which had offered even more money. So that didn't work. And this plant closing in this very hard economic time happened to coincide with the election of a very conservative governor who was cutting some of the very social programs that people who had been middle-class people in Janesville had never needed before, but suddenly they were falling out of the middle class. So there wasn't a lot of state help, although there was a little bit. The federal government put a lot of money into job retraining. So there were a few thousand people who had been factory workers who went back to school at a small college right in Janesville that does this kind of training. What I found was that even though people tried hard, the college tried hard to make this work, the factory workers tried hard, even those that finished their programs at this little college weren't always able to find a job. So it wasn't a sure path back to the middle class. But the federal government was putting money into retraining. It turns out that Janesville's a very resilient community, and it had lots of community nonprofits and a real tradition of generosity of fundraising. So when I was spending time in Janesville, I hung out at a little food pantry where there were people waiting in line early in the morning before it opened at 9 a.m. who used to be donors when they had good jobs and now were recipients of food aid. I hung out a little health clinic that was just slammed with more people who wanted to be patients than they could possibly handle. So every week on Wednesday was intake day for new patients, and I hung out to see who got in and who didn't get in. So even though these nonprofits were doing an awful lot of fundraising, and even though people in town who could afford to were being very generous, there was just more need than there was help. So one thing that I learned by getting to know people in Janesville is that falling out of the middle class is very different than having been poor all along. People, at least the ones I got to know, were used to taking care of themselves and were very reluctant to ask for help, even when their finances had kind of fallen apart. And, you know, I don't know how true that is of other communities. I mean, I spent close to 6 years getting to know people in this one little Wisconsin city. But I think it's something to think about as other places have also lost industry. You know, what's it like for these people? What do they need? What can they accept that doesn't wound their pride? It's a really big deal to lose work. It's not just a matter of losing an income. It's a matter of losing often your sense of identity, your sense of security, your sense of taking care of your family. So I think those are big questions that aren't just relevant to people in southern Wisconsin, but people in all kinds of communities where good jobs have been going away. Mm-hmm.